be seated. Well, little did we think last year at this time that this would be how we would meet this year at this time. Truly, it is true. Sometimes it's good not to know what's coming down the pike at you. But this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. So on behalf of all the folks of St. Armand's Quay Lutheran Church, on behalf of the clergy of St. Armand's and Longboat Quays, welcome. And welcome to everyone of all denominations and faiths that are joining us tonight online, or who have looked up or stumbled across this worship service in the archives. Welcome this night, in person and virtually. Welcome one and all. I want to introduce to you some of the participants tonight. Father David Marshall of All Angels by the Sea Episcopal Church has been slightly delayed, but he is here now, and he's just putting on his party frock, and he will join us momentarily. Over my left shoulder is the Reverend Dr. Norman Pritchard from Christ Church of Longboat Quay. He also talks a little funny. The new guy on the block is over on the right of the altar there, the Reverend Brock Patterson of Longboat Island Chapel. Welcome, Brock. You know me, if you don't by now, I'm Ken Blythe, and I'm the pastor here at St. Armand's Quay. Immediately to my right is Father Robert from St. Mary, Star of the Sea Chapel. Welcome, Father Robert. And last, but absolutely by no means least, our good friend, Rabbi Stephen Snyderman, sitting to the right of Father Robert. My sincere thanks to Anne Stevenson Moe, to Michael Bodnick, and to all of the musicians, singers here tonight, welcome. Thank you for enriching this worship with your God-given talents. I know time is precious at this time of year. Thank you for giving that precious time to us here tonight. Welcome. As you leave worship, you'll see some baskets, some collection bowls by the door. If you are moved, give generously. It has been our tradition at these worship services that that any donations given go to local food pantries so that those who are less fortunate than us might know some of the blessings that we know and that we enjoy. So please be generous. Sadly, there is no fellowship tonight. It's actually my favourite bit of the evening. Because whatever house of worship we go to, it's always so beautifully, so splendidly, and so lovingly prepared. Tonight, we've got nothing for you, except our love and our best wishes that you and yours, from us and ours, might have a blessed and happy and joy-filled Thanksgiving. So now I invite you to stand. Let us pray. Lord, your constant love reaches the heavens. Your faithfulness extends to the skies. Your righteousness is towering like the mountains. Your justice is like the depth of the sea. We find protection under the shadow of your wings. We feast on the abundant food you provide. You are the source of all life. And because of your light, we see the light. Be with us this evening and forevermore. Amen.
The presidential proclamation, Abraham Lincoln, 1863. It is the duty of nations as well as of people to own their dependence upon the overriding rule of God, to confess their sin and transgressions in humble sorrow, yet with assured hope that genuine repentance will lead to mercy and pardon, and to recognize that sublime truth, announced in the Holy Scriptures and proved by all history, that those nations are blessed whose God is the Lord. We have been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have been preserved these days in peace and prosperity. We have grown in numbers, wealth, power, as no other nation has ever grown. But we have forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom and virtue of our own, intoxicated with unbroken success, as we become self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to God. It has seemed to me fit and proper that God should be solemnly, reverently, and gratefully acknowledged as with one heart and one voice by the whole American people. I do therefore invite my fellow citizens in every part of the United States, and also those who are at sea and those who are sojourning in foreign lands, to set apart and observe the fourth Thursday of November as a day of thanksgiving and praise to our beneficent Father who dwells in the heavens. This we humbly, gladly do. Thanks be to God.
And now I have the opportunity to introduce to you Father David Marshall.
Let us approach God with a true heart, in full assurance of God's power to heal and forgive sins. Merciful God, you have loved your people from the beginning of time, desiring that we also love you and our neighbor with fullness of heart. We confess that we often seek wealth or security for ourselves without acting generously toward others. Forgive us and point us in your ways that we might reflect your will for us and your creation. Amen. God's promises fill our lives and give purpose to our days. With grateful hearts, we give thanks to God for all his gifts and rejoice in his understanding love. Amen.
Amen. O God, to whom we come so often with needs to be satisfied, we come to you now in gratitude for what we already have and are. For gifts beyond deserving or counting, we give thanks. You have given us the ability to become more than we have been, the urge to be more than we are, and the gnawing hunger to attain heights only dimly imagined. For the power to grow, we give thanks. You have endowed us with the capacity to discern the difference between right and wrong. You have enabled us to choose the right and to avoid the wrong. For the power to choose, we give thanks. You have blessed us with the ability to fashion things of beauty, to sing new songs, to add to the treasure house of human civilization. For the power to create, we give thanks. You have equipped us with a yearning to commune with you, to bring you our fears and our dreams, our hurts and our joys, our guilt and our gratitude, to share hopes and concerns with you and with others. For the power to pray, we give thanks. You have fortified us with the ability to rise above disappointments and failure, to go on after we have been bruised and bereaved, to refuse to submit to defeat and despair. For the power to hope, we give thanks. You have blessed us with the ability to cherish others, to make their lives as dear to us as our very own, to share their hopes, to feel their hearts, to know their hearts. For the power to love, we give thanks. You have ennobled us with the strength to overcome our faults, to mend our ways, and to answer the summons to turn to you with all our heart, mind, and soul. For the possibilities of renewal, we give thanks. Amen.
Therefore, keep the commandments of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with flowing streams, with springs and underground waters welling up in valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey, a land where you may eat bread without scarcity, where you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron, and from whose hills you may mine copper. You shall eat your fill and bless the Lord your God for the good land that has been given you. Take care that you do not forget the Lord your God by failing to keep his commandments, his ordinances, and his statutes, which I am commanding you today. When you have eaten your fill and have built fine houses and live in them, and when your herds and flocks have multiplied, and your silver and gold is multiplied, and all that you have is multiplied, then do not exalt yourself, forgetting the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who led you through the great and terrible wilderness, an arid wasteland with poisonous snakes and scorpions. He made water flow for you from flint rock and fed you in the wilderness with manna that your ancestors did not know, to humble you and to test you, and in the end to do you good. Do not say to yourself, my power and the might of my own hand have gotten me this wealth, but remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, so that he may confirm his covenant that he swore to your ancestors, as he is doing today.
Thank you. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. Word of God, the people.
Our first reading this evening from Deuteronomy gave us Moses giving the people some instructions as they were about to enter the Promised Land. And the basic instruction was, no matter how good it gets, don't forget to be grateful and to give thanks. I wonder why he felt it necessary to make that point. My hunch is that he realized that settling into the Promised Land would not be easy. There would be homes that had to be created. There would be farms that had to be set up, infrastructure put in place, and the original inhabitants would have been anything but welcoming to the new arrivals. And so Moses wanted to have them look beyond these difficulties to the fact that there was still a lot to be grateful for. So he knew that thanksgiving would not be easy, but it would nonetheless be essential. Because beyond the difficulties, there were also the blessings. All the wilderness years of wandering were over. God's promises to the people were now being fulfilled, and the blessings of this new beginning were there to be enjoyed. So thanksgiving may not have been easy for them, but it wouldn't have been too hard either if they'd only paused to reflect. And that's often the way. Many years ago now, in my hometown of Glasgow, Scotland, there was a pastor who became a kind of personality because of a habit he made peculiarly his own. Every worship service he conducted, he began with a prayer of thanksgiving. No matter what else was going to happen in the service, before the choir sang a note, before the congregation could join in praise, he began with a prayer of thanksgiving. Well, Scotland being Scotland, there was this particular Sunday when the rain was soaking people, that soft, never-ending rain that seems to get right into you and just depress you and weigh you down. And lots of people stayed home that day. And the few who gathered for worship joked with the ushers that the pastor would find it kind of hard to offer a prayer of thanksgiving on such a miserable morning. So the service began. In came the pastor. "Let us pray," he said. "O God," he said, "we thank you that every day is not like today." And the point he made, I think, is worth our reflecting on in this very difficult year. If you look hard enough, you'll always find occasions to give thanks. You don't need me to rehearse all the many ways in which the pandemic has disrupted our normal lives. Disrupted them so much so that even the word normal is now shot through with nostalgia. And we think of normal in terms of the good old days we used to enjoy. The trauma has been real. The loss of life, terrible. the loss of so many people's jobs and homes, frightening. The old normal gone, it would seem, for the foreseeable future. And even the Thanksgiving holiday has been disrupted. And this service with it. Instead of the large congregation and the full celebration, a select few, but a few united in thanksgiving nonetheless. And we're reminded that thanksgiving, even in these difficult times, is not impossible. Remember early in the spring when the pandemic really took hold, the people in Italy went onto their balconies of an evening and began singing at the top of their voices. In Britain, they tried to echo that, but they can't sing like Italians. So instead, they came outside and applauded the healthcare workers in the National Health Service. And I remember in those early months, listening one night to a radio program which did a news item acknowledging the many ways in which people were helping, particularly the doctors and nurses and medical personnel. And at the end of that little news item, the station's switchboard lit up. People began calling in, some people began emailing the station to add other people to the list of those who should be thanked. Shopkeepers, utility workers, postal workers, truckers delivering goods, bakers baking bread. Someone even added a link to a spoof news item in which a sports commentator denied the opportunity to make commentary on some sports game because, of course, all the sports had been cancelled. Instead, posted little movie clips of people crossing pedestrian walkways. Only he commented on their crossing with the kind of excitement that would be reserved for the closing stages of the Kentucky Derby. Just to brighten people's spirits and do something to help in the midst of all the gloom. And of course, that dynamic is something which almost every pastor knows about. We could all tell stories of people who have come through major health crises and found, as a result, a new perspective on life and a new appreciation of many of the things that they'd been taking for granted and forgetting to acknowledge with thanks. The country singer Mary Chapin Carpenter had a number of years ago a major health crisis, which happily passed, but left her feeling very low and depressed in the early days of her convalescence. She ventured out to shop for some groceries one day, and as she tells it, the clerk at the checkout counter said to her that he hoped she would enjoy the rest of that day. She said, "I looked at him and knew that he meant it. It stopped me in my tracks. I went out and sat in my car and cried. What I want more than ever is to appreciate that I have this day and tomorrow and hopefully days beyond that. I am experiencing the learning curve of gratitude. I don't want to say, have a nice day like a robot. I don't want to get mad at the elderly driver in front of me." She'd obviously never driven Gulf of Mexico Drive. "I don't want to go crazy when my internet access is messed up. I don't want to be jealous at someone else's success. Tonight, I will cook dinner and tell my husband how much I love him, curl up with the dogs, watch the sun go down over the mountains, and climb into bed. I will think about how uncomplicated it all is. I will wonder at how it took me my entire life to appreciate just one day. I love that expression, the learning curve of gratitude. Learning to see the blessings that day by day are ours and day by day quite often go unacknowledged. You see, in a time of crisis, whether it's a national crisis like we're going through now or a personal one that afflicts us in our own lives, it is all too easy to focus on the crisis and let it fill the foreground of our minds and block out everything else, including all the good things that are still fine in our lives. The crisis can become so all-consuming that we miss the blessings we still enjoy, things for which we should be thankful. And I think one of the reasons the scriptures are full of calls to praise God and give thanks is to help us remember the good gifts and push us up the learning curve of gratitude. I suspect that one of the reasons we have trouble with giving thanks goes back to our childhood days, when no matter how inappropriate Aunt Agatha's birthday gift to us was, and it usually was, we were still required to write a thank you note. "Oh, Mom, do I have to?" we would complain. And giving thanks became a burden which spoiled the gift. In fact, the very opposite should be true. Saying thanks enhances the gift, extends it. If you like, thanksgiving is recollection, recollection, collecting it again. First, we receive a gift and we enjoy it. Then, when we give thanks, the recollection of the gift allows the gift to delight us again. It's kind of the way photographs work. Have you thought? Photographs can offer, in fact, a great activity for the reduced Thanksgiving that we're all going to have to live through in a couple of days. Our photographs take us back to all the things recorded from past years and invite us to remember, to recollect, to revisit them. A family trip, a special meal, a graduation, a special get-together with friends, all those things. And even if you have photographs which make you shudder, you know, Rebecca's appalling boyfriend or Sean's dreadful haircut during his rebellious years, even so, you can look back on them and be grateful, at least be grateful that they've passed. Oh God, we thank you that every day is not like that one in the photograph. And that's what Thanksgiving is for. It recollects the gifts that we've been given and lets us see how deeply we are blessed. As the psalmist encourages us, "O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever." Let us pray. In this year of pandemic, loving God, you have blessed us through those who have served selflessly and given generously to others. We think especially of those in the medical professions who have put their lives at risk to care for those who are sick. We remember others also who gave of themselves, caring for the sick, helping the needy, comforting the bereaved, encouraging the fearful. Gracious God, amid the blessings of each new day, we acknowledge these special blessings this year. And beyond the difficulties, we seek to affirm your goodness and give you thanks and praise. This we gladly do. Amen.
This has been the thanks part of our program. We now enter the giving part of our program. Normally we would pass an offering plate around, but for this time of year we will not. We have it in the back. For those that are watching us online right now, you have the easiest way to give. You can find the charity of your choice, and that in giving thanks, to give to help others. The need is great, and the gifts that we have to give are even greater. Let us pray. For gifts to bring that express our thanksgiving, we give thanks. For love and goodness received, we praise and bless your name. For blessings known throughout our lives, sometimes even unacknowledged, and for all that tells the goodness of our God, we give glad and grateful praise. Amen.
Worship service draws to a close tonight. A special remembrance of our beloved friend, Monsignor Jerry Finnegan, of blessed memory, whom we miss so much tonight. And our prayers and our love and our best wishes go out to his sisters across the sea. To those particularly joining us at home tonight, we know, we clergy, that sometimes you are estranged from your worship community, from the tradition in which you grew up. You see in this sanctuary ministers, priests, a rabbi from all of the houses of worship on St. Armand's and Longboat. And we invite you with all of our hearts that if you are estranged from your faith, to reach out to us, especially at this time of thanksgiving. Should you need us, we are here. And on behalf of my fellow clergy, I say we will be delighted and honored to welcome you home. Let us pray. God, keep us safe in danger. Give us courage and keep us loving. God, help us to speak the truth and to stand by those who need our help. God, give us friends who love us, places and people that help us grow. God, send us on our way rejoicing and welcome us safely home. Amen.